never thought I'd do an electric on this show because I love the internal combustion engine, but I also want to drive everything. This 1976 911 is the one that makes me realize I can't be a hypocrite, even if that car is cursed. Hi, Chris.
Hi.
You are one of my very favorite builders. We've had two other episodes with you, but this is a different car.
Right.
For me.
Right. It's different for me too. It's different than everything else I have.
So what is this?
This is your typical bone stock 911. Nice restoration. No. It's no. Very far from that.
Right.
So this is a 1976 electric wide body race car Porsche 911.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
So, okay. I am definitely, you know, into internal combustion engines and the noise and the smell, all of that. I thought quite a bit about, you know, if I was ever going to do an electric car, drive one, this one is pretty special. Tell me your story about acquiring this car, because it's got a kind of a really weird history.
Right. So, you know, I like race cars.
Yeah.
I didn't know much about air-cooled Porsches. And so this was going to be my foray into that stuff.
Right.
So then
so it had the cage and all of this wide body when you acquired it?
Yeah.
Okay.
So John James Racing, his dad built it, Jim. So it was street car converted to full-blown race car, then converted back to street car, taken to cars and coffees and stuff like that. And then that's the condition that I bought it in.
So it had an air-cooled engine in it when you bought it.
It did. It
was it stock? Or
it was a little bit hopped up, but compared to what I'm used to driving, you know, I wouldn't consider it like fast. But I was happy to just have it and drive it, and I was really enjoying that for 2 months. And then the mudslide happened. The garage filled up with mud.
Wait a second. So we're in California, which catches on fire every year.
Right.
Which creates mudslides when it rains.
Yes.
And you were near all of
your
previous burns.
So there were wildfires, but it didn't burn the house down. So we were like, yay, we made it. Like, we were so lucky.
Right.
And then about 2 months later, we had a really big rainstorm and the hill just let loose. So it did fill the garage with about 5 feet of mud. And the car, because it's got a kind of a bathtub bottom, just a pan, it floated. So the mud picked it up. And
Porsches always rise to the top.
Yeah. And it bounced around in the garage. So the body got beat up, the pan filled up with water, mud and rocks and stuff went in the exhaust. Mm. Like it was up over the rear bumper.
That's insane. And at this point, what's going on in your mind? Are you thinking like, how am I ever gonna bring these cars back? I mean, what are you thinking?
Just kind of in like survival mode, just dealing one step at a time with just whatever you can. Fuck. It took us 2 days. I had a whole bunch of friends that worked with me and people in the canyon that came over and helped. When I watch that video now, I get really emotional about it because there was so much, like there's just so much wrapped up in some sort of experience like that.
Yeah.
After that, I had already been talking to Electric GT about doing a conversion on an old car.
A Tesla swap.
Something.
Something.
Yeah.
Something.
And I didn't know what, but I was like, wait a minute. Why don't I just convert this one to electric?
Mm-hmm.
It's wide body, it's got racing suspension on it, it's made to handle more horsepower already.
Yeah.
So it's the perfect candidate.
How much is fiberglass on this car?
So the hood, the front fenders, the rear deck lid, the rear fenders, and rear bumper are now fiberglass. The rest of it, the roof, the doors, and the cowl are steel.
How much does it weigh right now?
2,800 pounds. I don't know what it weighed before. Electric GT, I think it was about 500 pounds more compared to when they do these conversions.
Sure.
So we went to SEMA in 2021.
Okay.
After SEMA, we had a couple incidents.
Okay, so this car is kind of cursed. Or on its way to being cursed.
Or it has nine lives or something.
And we're hoping that it doesn't, the curse doesn't come out
right
on our drive.
Yeah. Yeah. So to be clear, also, like, I bought it in 21. It's now 24. And I'm driving it really on the street for the first time.
Because it's been crashed three times in under 30 miles.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and I take responsibility for most of that. As you do when you get over ambitious, I had in mind, like, it was a race car and it has 17 inch wheels on it, and it's hard to find 17 inch tires, like modern high performance tires, but they make a lot of slicks in 17 still. So I was like, well, it's a race car. We'll just put some street legal slicks on it, right? The whole shop goes out to the street to watch me drive it down the street. I rolled onto the throttle and the tires spun and it hooked left and I went right into the curb. And it damaged the fender, it bent the rear swing arm, it bent a wheel.
And you have an audience.
And the whole shop watched me do it. And they all know I have other cars and I autocross. And so it was like incredibly embarrassing.
And at that time you didn't have a limited slip?
Didn't have a limited slip. So that's one huge issue with the Tesla drive units. Okay. Is that they're open differentials.
Okay.
So the way Tesla manages it, though, is that they monitor wheel spin and then they modulate the brakes. So now we're decoupling from anything, any Tesla software. So we're just using their motor and we're using separate software. And so there's no wheel speed monitoring, no traction control, no way to modulate the brakes.
So just like in a traditional axle that's not under an electric drivetrain, the power is still going to go to the wheel with least resistance in an open differential.
Right. And whichever one happens to spin quicker, it tends to kick the car one direction or the other. So then after I crashed it, it went back to electric GT. They were updating the firmware and they rebooted the car. They were in the car with a laptop. And for some reason, the car went into throttle mode. And so there was a second accident.
0 miles between first and second crash.
Yeah, pretty much. Pretty much, yeah. Everybody's learning about all of this stuff. That got sent over to Auto Addiction OC. And at that point, we said, okay, well, let's just rework the whole car. Like, paint the whole car, fix all the cracks in the fiberglass. So it finally gets done. It's all painted and everything. It goes back to electric GT because we're going to put that limited slip differential in the car, right? We're going to make it safer. So they take the Tesla drive unit out, they put a limited slip in, they put it all back together, they go to test drive it and proceed to put it onto a center island and they smash the left front side of it.
Is it just wickedly fast? I mean, what's happening at this point that it's...
It's a combination of things. So with the electric cars, like, for one, there's no traction control on it. There's instant torque. There's also no gears, like a...
You're not shifting gears.
You're not shifting gears, right? So your pedal goes from 0 to 130, the throttle pedal. So once the tires break loose, they will go
quickly
crazy. You let off the gas, it just kind of keeps going. You got to dial in more regen, and then you just have to
Regenerative braking,
right? So that when you let off the gas, the engine will try to work to generate power and it creates some resistance and it will slow the rear tires back down. So it makes it a little bit more manageable. I sent it to Elephant Racing and had them go through and put their nicest suspension setup on it and corner weighted, corner balanced and everything and aligned.
So she's ready for her fourth maiden voyage.
Yes.
Is that where we're at with this?
Yes.
And you've only barely gotten it back into your hands, like, just what, a week or two ago?
Yeah. A couple weeks. So we've charged the battery, I think, like, twice.
Look, Chris.
Right?
She thick?
Yeah.
She's thicker than a bowl of oatmeal?
Yeah. So when it was at the paint shop, they had the deck lid off. So the whole whale tail thing was off.
It kind of like pseudo got your imagination of what
and
it
was looking
like.
At it and I was like, oh, wow, without the big whale tail, I can see the other fender when I'm looking at this fender. I can see both fenders. And for some reason, it just looked way wider and more slick.
Right.
And Skyler at the shop, he was like, well, you don't need a vent, right? Because it's electric now. And I was like, oh, you're right. So we filled it in. And so that's kind of one of the cool things on the car is that...
It's such blasphemy. All of that. This is... I just
love the thought that a Porsche owner might be behind this on the freeway or something and then go, that looks cool. And they go, wait, why does that look so weird? And then they realize that there's no vent.
It's
and then that makes them wonder, like, how is there no vent? Like, how's the engine breathing? It's like, oh, yeah.
Sure. But it is really, really, like, obscenely wide. And that's very much a John James Racing look. And he had the Lexan windows with the metal
right.
straps.
Yeah, so that's a plexi rear window, mm-hmm. and you can see it's got scratches on it and stuff. And then the taillights, I'm probably going to butcher the guy's name, but it's Lauren Till. He makes small batch, like custom taillights. They're
and
really
those are
cool
LEDs. Looking.
They are LEDs.
I love the vents.
Yeah, so the rear vents turbulent air out because mm-hmm. the fenders are so wide. And then in the front, it scoops in air for the rear brakes.
Cools them off.
Yeah.
You got a little Satan there. What's that,
I don't
little
know,
devil
I don't,
guy? A little goat like, devil? What is that?
I would
that?
Say it's a lesser imp.
It's okay. Whatever he is, he serves Satan.
There's a little monster hiding inside. So in the darkness there, you catch a glimpse of it. Got our little push pins. And then what you're seeing here is a bunch
a
of
box.
Stuff. It's, yeah. This is a battery pack. So okay. it's got a battery pack in the rear and a battery pack in the front. So you're splitting that weight. The goal from Electric GT was keep the same weight proportion balance front and rear. It still should handle and feel like a 911 on the road.
I think it's okay for us to admit that, like, this is foreign territory.
Mm-hmm.
It's
and I'm trying
weird.
To learn along with everybody else. And, like, you know, we're on the frontier of this stuff right now, especially the actual code and how the electric motors are tuned and the amount of voltage and power and stuff at this scale. Like, it's tougher than everybody thought.
You know, so in 100 years, if they go back and watch this video, they'll be like, they had no idea. But this is new stuff. I've never been around this before.
Right. Yep. Something very cool about Electric GT's kit is it's non-destructive. The battery pack uses the motor mount holes.
You could always take it out and put another.
It's not, you're not cutting it up. You're not destroying it in the process. Although this was a race car, so it was already cut up. You can see the reservoirs for the coolers on both sides, which
is
pretty neat.
So it's water cooled. There's
yes.
a radiator or?
Two radiators.
Okay.
One sends cooler water through the battery pack mm-hmm. and one says cooler water through the motor.
It's very aggressive.
Mm-hmm.
It's very aggressive. What I like is it has the original frame.
Mm-hmm. But it's got plexi windows in it
yeah.
on the side and the back.
Oh,
and the front
really
windshield
cool.
is not epoxied in. It's just a old school gasket around
okay.
the flange. So those front retention tabs are like actually needed on the track.
So you have carbon fiber side skirts.
Right.
Your little Ruffian logo on it.
Yeah, so these are actually off of our 67 Mustang.
Oh.
We built side skirts for that, and then we made molds, and now we're producing those in carbon and selling them.
I like the bullet mirrors that are like on,
yeah,
like those
yeah.
little brackets. That's also very John James, isn't it?
It is.
And I also like that it's just a factory handle too, nothing
mm-hmm.
fancy. You still retain some original 911 parts.
Right.
Which was very cool.
Yep.
Like, I glanced in there and noticed your e-brake. Your tires are different, but were these wheels on the car?
Yes.
When you got it?
Yeah, these are John James.
Okay.
335s in the rear, and I think 275s in the front.
It's big. Total clearance?
Yeah.
From full lock?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. So you still have a full mechanical linkage and everything in the front?
Yeah, the steering is still Porsche.
Mm-hmm.
The brakes are 930.
Yeah.
From the faster mm-hmm. version.
From the turbos.
From the turbos, yeah.
Yep.
So we filled the hole in the front bumper where the oil mm-hmm. cooler was. We don't have an oil cooler because we don't have any oil. So we filled that.
Hold on a minute. You've solved the problem of the leaking Porsche.
No more.
There's
leaking
no
oil.
Oil to leak.
Yeah, my floor's clean.
Wow.
Yeah. Those headlights are LED conversions from Renline that I put on the car later.
They're very cool. Did I do that? Oh.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, guess what? Another box.
Another box. This is where the fuel tank would have been.
Yeah, and the little spare tire that would collapse down to nothing.
Back
you
in
can
the day.
See your steering linkage
mm-hmm.
and all of that.
Yeah, that's all original Porsche stuff.
Yeah.
There's a fire suppression system.
Mm-hmm.
It does have a little 12-volt battery in here.
Mm-hmm. To run
so
what?
The 12 volt battery boots up the whole system. And then once it's booted up, the big batteries charge the little battery.
did you know we have awesome merch? It's all premium quality, which is super important to me. You have to stop. I love premium. We have variety. You're missing me. You can't get me. Huge variety. Great merch and awesome price. Something for everyone. This doesn't work. Well, if you love this show and you want to support us, head on over to NicoleJohnsonsDetour.com and get your merch on, baby.
So this is the Tesla drive unit.
Okay.
This is from a Model S, a non-sport unit. So it's 450 horsepower, 332, I think, foot-pounds of torque.
Okay.
So, but that's all the time, like regardless of what the RPM range is or anything. So even though that number is not massive, like it feels a lot stronger than that. I think personally, the car feels like it has 600-700 horsepower.
So this is part of the battery that we were seeing.
This is the bottom of the batteries and the two coolers. The center section is a differential. Tesla is like what would be your transaxle.
And that's where you're putting your limited slip.
Yeah, so
in
the
there?
Electric motor, yeah. Okay. Electric motor has a gear on it and it spins the gears inside of here. And then these half shafts are going from the Tesla drive unit to the Porsche swing arms.
Yeah, so with your transaxle being gone, everything outside of that is still Porsche.
Yes.
Right.
So we just have custom axles to adapt the Tesla drive unit to the Porsche hubs.
So what is meant by direct drive? This is a direct drive system?
Yeah, just because you can't change gears or anything. It's one gear ratio, that's it. This setup, the gear ratio is somewhere between what is normally first and second gear, as far as the multiplying, because it's geared down. I think it's like 9-something to 1. So it's like, imagine if you're in your gas powered car, if you could be basically in first or second gear and go all the way to top speed in that gear.
It's very weird. Okay, let's look at your suspension, because that's all brand spanking new.
Yeah, so you can tell these swing arms are refurbished.
Right, but that's Porsche components.
It's all Porsche stuff, yeah.
Sway bar.
New coilovers, new hubs. These are the 930 brakes that have been on it since it was a race car.
Okay.
You can kind of see here, this front bit, that this Tesla drive unit is bolted up to stock like motor mount positions.
Is this just really thick bracing here?
Yeah.
Thick steel here.
And then because that thing's kind of so thick, this rear sway bar, they had to add little spacers.
Sure, because it was, it almost wants to collide with it.
Yeah. So this is adjustable rear sway bar.
Okay.
With these, that's why all these holes here.
I don't know, I feel like my brain is still processing how strange this is to look at. Yeah, parts of it look like a Porsche, and then you go, I don't know what I'm looking at, and it says Tesla right here.
Yeah, this is the Elephant Racing front suspension setup, so the lower control arm, the strut with adjustable camber and such at the camber plates at the top.
Right.
Just a non-power rack and pinion, just the Porsche stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And then adjustable front sway bar. These here have spacers for your end links, so that you can adjust for a bump steer. This bit here is the bottom of the front battery pack. 1976, just the power plant is electric.
Yeah, it's a little Frankenstein. Well, there's nothing to it. It's just a race car.
Race car.
It's very, very Spartan. It's just a cage.
Yep, there's no back seat. Full cage.
There's nothing to it. There is a detachable steering wheel.
Gotta have that.
And then I have to find all the splines to put it back. There we go.
That's the AEM digital dash. This is your drive selection. You can put it into different torque amounts. So you can dial down the motor, make it slower.
How would you turn it on?
There's a power kill switch here. That's the main battery shut off.
Got it.
And then the wake button actually boots up the computer.
Okay, so it's woke. If I turn
not
it on,
yet.
It'll be woke?
Yeah, but then, yeah.
Is it going to do anything?
Oh. It'll boot up.
Oh, yeah, it sounds like your PC booting up.
Yeah.
Cool.
So then you have different screens, different settings you can cycle through.
Oh, weird. No way. Is that every one of your batteries?
Yeah, it's all the cells. So you can look at the voltage.
I love how they look like a bunch of double ends.
Yeah.
That's all it looks like.
Yep.
I just want to fire it up. I'm waiting for, okay, like the fans come on. I just want to fire it up and there's nothing more to do.
Yep.
It's done. So I can turn it off for now.
Sure.
Is that what I do? Oh, much better.
Yeah.
Okay, so what do you got over here? You got your
turn signals because it's race car, so it's not on the column. And then a headlight switch.
Right.
Yep. And then wiper switch, super simple. Oh. And then we've got a proportioning valve here for the rear brakes. So that on, you know, if you were on a racetrack and you needed to adjust the rear bias.
Yes. So more or less.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
More or less.
More or less. And a little tiny little.
Yeah, that's the factory Porsche brake pedal. And then a little.
Looks so out of place.
Yeah, the little sliding glass. And then the seats that we're sitting in, these are Porsche GT2 carbon buckets.
These are nice, they're comfortable.
I actually bought these for my 70 Mustang.
Oh.
And then it kind of didn't suit the style.
Yeah, and then very simple little pull.
Yeah, just a fabric latch pull. And there's no inner door skin anymore. The cage actually protrudes into where the,
where the door
would have been.
Awesome, all right, let's take off.
Okay.
Wait a minute. Let's not take off until we clear something here. I came into this with a lot of bias against electric.
You must not have had RC cars.
Well, no.
That's what I keep telling people.
I had
RC
cars.
How could you grow up with RC cars and have all that fun and then be so negative on electric car as an adult? It's like, but it's the same stuff, but bigger. And
you're just riding the RC car.
You are. You're in it. You get to play. You get to play. So like for me, this is a fun toy.
Oh my gosh, Chris.
Let's be fine. Punch it.
I love it. Whoop! There goes your window.
Yeah.
I love it. It's very cool.
Hey, we did a launch and we didn't wreck it.
Is that like, yeah. That's the first time.
Good.
Wow. Oh my gosh. Okay, that's pretty fun. Wow. You can't like not smile, huh?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Oh my gosh. Does it feel weird sitting there?
It does.
For you?
It does.
It's fun. I'm trying not to admit I like it. I love the trees.
Right.
Yeah. doesn't feel, sitting right here right now, doesn't feel any different than my 911.
Uh-huh.
Right? Because I got the same view.
Right.
I'm looking at essentially the same dash and fenders. My steering feels a little offset to the right, and yours feels centered in the seat.
Oh.
And that might have been that John James set it up that way.
Right.
Because they're typically just a wee off. And it doesn't bother me right now that I'm not hearing an engine, because I feel like if you're just on a highway cruising, you might not miss that too much. Okay, the regen is weird because I don't really need the brakes. I'm not even pushing the brakes.
Right.
I'm not pushing the brakes. And now I'm pushing the brakes.
Right.
That's super weird.
Yeah, it's nice because you're capturing all of that energy. On the speedometer, you got this green line. That's how much energy you're using.
Mm.
You'll actually see another arrow come up and go negative here. And that's how much energy that you're regenerating.
So if it's below this line, you're making
power. Yes. And then if it's above, then you're spending it.
I like the lack of power steering. Like, it feels perfect.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Nice. Good.
It cradles your back like there's a hand pushing you along.
Right?
It just feels like somebody's behind you leading a dance.
Uh-huh.
If I want to slow a wee bit going into the turn.
Uh-huh.
It doesn't have, like, the like lift off throttle, like oversteer, you know, like in a gas powered car.
Yeah.
You suddenly, the snapping off of the throttle will whip that rear end around because it'll transfer weight.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
And I don't feel like this car is going to do that because it has the regen braking.
Yeah, there you go. There's a battery manager. When you charge the battery, it gives more energy to the cells that are low than the cells that are high.
Yeah.
But it can't do it all in one charge. So it's definitely a process of deplete the battery, charge the battery, deplete the battery.
Yeah.
And over time, the cells become more matched.
Right.
And honestly, there are more and more people every day that don't that like cars, but that don't understand carburetors or Webers and how to tune them, and they smell, and like there's a whole bunch of baggage that comes with old cars.
And because we don't have turbo lag like a 930, it's probably safer with this weight distribution than a 930 would have been, to be honest. Because you don't have the turbo lag.
You're not getting surprised by the onslaught of power and torque suddenly.
Yeah. And when we accelerate, it feels awesome. It has some torque squat.
Yeah, I love the way this car squats, and it makes it feel more, it just makes it fun, as opposed to something that didn't squat at all.
This is actually pretty cool. Dude, this is so much fun. I surprisingly enjoyed myself.
Awesome.
I loved it. And thank you so much for letting me experience this.
Yeah, I'm glad that we got to learn about the car together.
So I want you guys to tell me what you think of this. I'm expecting all ends of the spectrum, and I can take it. And let me know if you guys had fun. I'll catch you next time. But I also want to drive everything. And this is pretty mind-blowing. I sounded like Doug DeMiro there. Look at inverter fault. I broke your car.
Sorry.